Hey guys, this is Adam Gussow from Satan and Adam. Remember when I used to introduce every one of my videos like that? That struck many people as funny. Well, I'm happy to say that I'm still a part of that act. And we not only have a single out there, we now have an album. The first new Satan and Adam album in 15 years. It's called Back in the Game. And as I recover from our wonderful event, Hill Country Harmonica, which I got to meet a few of you and got to play with Sterling, the reunion of Sterling, Mr. Satan McGee, and yours truly, I thought that what I would do, apart from letting you know that the album is now in full release, well, it's in full release, but it's as a digital download, so I'm not yet selling the hard copy CDs. But you can go to the link that I'll put below this video in the extended description and maybe after the video. If you're interested, you can take a listen to a preview of five songs and maybe pick up a copy as a digital download. It has 10 songs there. It's 40 minutes long. It's 8 of the songs were recorded in the last year and a half, and 2 of them are kind of curiosities. One of them is from the original Harlem Blues session back in 1990. Kind of a crazy over-the-top cut called Listen to the Music. And the other was actually a live in-studio appearance. It's kind of tricky to take a live studio appearance when you're at a radio station. And they've got basically two mics, the two vocal mics, kind of aimed at your stuff, to take that and turn it into a cut that it is album-worthy. But we managed to do it. With a lot of work this past winter. Anyway, it's available for download at TradeBit, which is where I sell my stuff. And as of July 4th, it should be out there on iTunes and Amazon and all that stuff. And I should be offering hard copy CDs, so look for those links in the description. What I want to do is I want to play you a little bit of the second cut on the album, and I think I'll do a couple of videos, which is called... let me take this out. Check this out. We've got, of course, a photo on the back. That's Sterling McGee and myself. And then in the middle, Dave Laycock, our drummer, who was not on the album. He got ill, was not able to play on the album. And then in the middle, I think it's kind of funny, is a cut of us when we were much younger men. This was taken at the International Busker Fest in Halifax, Nova Scotia, in 1990. So that's a long time ago, 21 years ago. Anyway, that's why we call it Back in the Game. Can put those guys up on the shelf, but there they are. They're not supposed to be around, but we are still kicking and stomping. Anyway, let me play a little bit of a cut that Sterling and I have been doing for a long time, Broken Hungry. He used to call it Broken Homeless. So check it out. You need a C harp. Now, you know, when I listen to that, what I was trying to do there is I'm comping. I'm not playing lead, and I think a lot of harmonica players, when they think about playing harmonica, they think about either playing solo, right, kind of walking down the street, or they think about taking a solo when they're at a jam session. And it's easier to think about those two things, kind of filling up all the space or flying out over the top. It's much harder to imagine how you take a kind of loud, raucous, non-mellow instrument like the harmonica and have it be an accompanying instrument. And yet that's a whole lot of what blues harmonica is about, and it's not discussed as much as it should be. So I thought I would talk just a little bit using this album, this cut from the album as an example. So the first thing to think about if you're going to be a comping harmonica player, and by the way, I'm going to interrupt myself, go and listen to Magic Dick on the early Jay Giles albums. great example of a harp player who's comping, partly because he's a sax player too, and what he's doing is kind of doing what a sax would do if the sax were comping. There's one key principle for he or she who would be a sideman, a comping harmonica player. When I say comp, I mean accompanying. So we talk about comping. I'm going to comp on that cut. And this is, first, do no harm. It's the Hippocratic Oath. It's the oath that doctors take, medical doctors. Okay. First, do no harm, which is to say, first, don't step all over the singer's vocals. And if you pay attention, you'll realize that singers, like harmonica players, have to breathe. Now, of course, harmonica players, we have an instrument that plays in and out, so we can kind of breathe through it. That's one of the problems. We're used to just, it's like we're breathing, we're talking. You ever meet somebody who just talks all the time and they just won't stop and they really don't leave any space, and they ask you a question and they answer it, right? And then they don't even give you a chance to respond. YouTube videos can be like that. So if you're going to comp, you have to find a breathing rhythm in which the singer sings and then you play. And there's a kind of back and forth so that the song breathes, right? So, and it's a little hard to teach it, of course, if I don't have the track playing along with me. But we'll go back and play it again. And what I want you to do is hear how I'm leaving a lot of space. So it's, well, I'm broke and homeless, raggedy animal. And of course, at certain moments, if I do a sort of a rhythm that does a little of this and leaves a space and does this, he may not always, I may occasionally step on his lyrics, but if I'm playing a regular pattern, this is actually the second truth about comping. It's really the truth about horn lines. If you go and listen to the old Ray Charles stuff, you'll realize that sometimes the horns are right out there blaring when Ray's singing. But no one individual horn is blaring over the top of Ray Charles. It's a horn line. And they're also doing a fairly regular pattern, right? And so when you do that, you don't draw undue attention to yourself. You're simply reinforcing what the singer's doing. The problem is when the harmonica kind of plays nonstop during, after, before, when the singer's singing. So let's just try a basic pattern, and I'll show you what I'm doing. Now you'll notice the other thing, of course, that helps you play the right way as a comping harmonica player is knowing how to take the volume down while maintaining a kind of a nice sound. And so that's crucial. It's not just about when you play. It's also about how loud you play or how loud you don't play. It's about the spaces you leave. And when you're loud, the loud should be in a repetitive way that doesn't call attention to itself. See, I think that called attention to itself. You get the idea? Let's go back. Let's listen again. I want you to listen to the opening line, but before we do, so you're going to listen for the vocals and the way the harp goes back and forth with the vocals. But what am I doing? So I'm tongue blocking, and notice, by the way, that I'm not playing harp on the first beat, so it's like one. I'm playing on the two. Boom. One, two, a three, two, a three, So what am I doing? That's that basic pattern. Well, I'm starting on the 2-5 draw, tongue blocked, and I'm playing a little bit more of the 5 draw than I am playing the 2 draw. Now, if I played everything equal, that's the sort of obvious way of doing it. All right, that's 2-5 draw, 2-5 blow, 1-4 draw, and then 2-5 blow. All right, but what I'm doing is I'm choking it off slightly. Now I'm playing mostly the 5 draw, but I'm not playing lip pursed. If I did that, it would sound like That's very different from... So even though it's mostly five draw, there's like that little 10 to 15% underpinning. It's a little bit like if you're going to make gumbo, you need a roux. You got to heat that oil and that flour and heat them up until they get nice and brown. And then when you add everything else, you get a kind of thickening undercurrent in the mix. That's what holds your gumbo together. And I would say that the tongue blocking in this case is exactly analogous to that. You get that little thickening thing of your tongue kind of slapping on and off, as opposed to not nearly as good, right? Lip pursed. See, some people think that I'm a lip purser because I overblow. But you know, there's a lot of comping stuff where it's all about tongue blocking in a subtle way for me. Okay, that's riff number one. One. And then the second riff, I'm going to start on the bent three draw, bent just about a half step, maybe a little less, with a little bit of the four in there, down to the two draw, just the two draw. Then back up to the three, bent down a whole step. And then back down to the two draw with no bend at all. So that tricky little riff requires you to do two different bends on the three, one of which has a little bit of the four hole and one of which, the harder one of which, doesn't have any four hole. And it requires you to release all that bending energy the moment you move to the two draw. And then, of course, the two blow. Okay, let's go back and let's play the track. Now that you have some general idea of what I'm doing. All right.
I'm broke and I'm homeless. Raggedy and I'm dirty too. I'm broke, homeless. Raggedy and I'm dirty too. Trying to treat myself a baby.
So I realized at the end, you know what you'll notice, I mean, I did several different variations. At the end I went, and what I did was, he was singing there, so I was actually playing while he was singing, but I know enough to back off the volume and to do something in it that's very sequential, that really moves in the same kind of rhythmic pattern as the drums. Da, da. And when you do that, you can get by with playing while the guy's singing. But you have to do it, it's really a feel thing. It's a taste thing. I didn't go, you know, that would be how I would pick it up if I were soloing. The place in which you develop these reflexes is actually on the bandstand. So that's where all of those hundreds of gigs that I've played, where I'm constantly adjusting my volume up and down by just breathing in a little harder or a little less. That's where that experience begins to show up, you see. So if you've never really played a live gig, you've just watched a lot of my videos and played along with them a lot, you're going to have some weaknesses. You're going to get out there and you got to actually play with people. You got to try to get your sound live in different rooms. You're going to maybe have an amp that doesn't work that well for you. In this case, I was using a couple of small amps, the amps that I use when I play live. I think this lesson's about over. We're at time right now. So I hope you enjoyed it. I'll come back with something pretty soon. And go and check out the album, Back in the Game, Satan and Adam. Bye-bye.
And I'm hungry. Raggedy and I'm dirty too. Oh, I'm broke and hungry. Raggedy and I'm dirty too. Do you remember last fall when nothing was in the refrigerator?